Hello everyone, my name is Nick Larin and I'm the lead developer at Pixel Reign.
And I'm Angelos Roditakis, 3D animator at Tamasenco. I had the pleasure to work alongside Nick and Pixel Reign for the past year to bring Neonverse to life. I will be sharing with you our mobile 3D asset creation workflow and go over a little bit about the techniques used.
I will share tips and best practices on how to combine vertex lighting with newer techniques to achieve rapid and beautiful results, animating in shaders instead of using animations and C# scripts and many more. So let's get started.
First things first, what is Neonverse about? It is a joint effort of two companies, Tamasenco and Pixel Reign, to evoke the old-school 2D nostalgia of top-down shooters in a game targeted for current mobile devices. In this title, you get to board a spaceship and fight against several space enemy factions.
Our topics for today are the following: limitations of mobile hardware, best practices to optimize 3D asset creation within these limitations to achieve performance goals, and in-editor demos showcasing optimized rendering and shader techniques in order to enhance the performance of our Unity game. The limitations of mobile hardware. While it has advanced in recent years, mobile hardware is much more inferior when compared to PCs or consoles. Gaming is a hardware-intensive task, so a lot of optimizations are needed to ensure proper performance. Since most smartphones are daily drivers, they are prone to have a lot of background applications, leaving less resources for the games. Some recent advancements even produce downsides, such as high-resolution screens. Having to render a 4K screen is many times more expensive than 1080p. Next is the 3D asset creation chapter. Angelos will take it up from here.
Thanks, Nick. So, let's talk about the start of it all, the concept art and direction. There was a very distinct visual identity coming from our art department for our ships and enemy races. There was a distinction between organic and mechanical forms, and the concepts were oozing personality in our eyes. This one should feel like a bulldozer, and it had to behave like heavy machinery, with a mouth and all. One of the bosses from the pirate race. And of course this alien boss should move like a crab-like organism. And this one is a player ship, and felt like a war helicopter. These are some examples of the wonderful pieces done by the awesome artist Manos Parakis. So it became very important for us early on to keep as much as possible of the style and character of the concept art into the final result that would go into Unity. The excellent optimized shader and lighting work, which will be described later in this presentation, allowed us to indulge ourselves in a small draw call overhead, but it was still a game targeted for a range of quite old mobile devices. As far as the asset pipeline is concerned, we could easily excessively reduce the poly count and do away with skinned meshes and long joint hierarchies. That way, we could have a very optimized output, which is not that uncommon for the mobile market. But as I said, our primary goal was to do the concept art justice, so to speak. Instead, I opted to work on them, borrowing methods from larger production houses with more powerful target platforms. And it seemed to work. This diagram explains more or less the route I followed. It's a common concept in game asset creation to follow a data-centric approach. This means that the production does not follow a straight path from mesh to texture, to rigging, to animation, definitely not for each asset individually, because it's inefficient. Instead, each part, the mesh, the texture, the rig components, the skin data, other configuration, the animation files, all are stored as data. These files then are versioned for iterations, debugging, fixes, reusability, and whatnot. Ultimately, the developers always get to work with the latest version and the result of those files in engine. I will try to cover some of the philosophy behind the tools I used and how it affected the result and helped me stay within the limitations we had. So I first started working on the base mesh. Instead of using it as a stepping stone for further prototyping or model exploration, I will try to get a final mesh out of it, meaning all polycan considerations, silhouette, volumes, and range of motion will be dealt with at this point. By range of motion, I mean that even though I have no rig yet to test it, the design document and the concept art describe all the motions this asset will be able to make and let me make an informed guess of how best to model deforming parts or separate rigid ones or do away with polygons that the player will never actually see. Then comes texturing. Since we will not be using normal mapping. I'm going to use the high poly mesh in ZBrush as the basis for a diffuse texture that I will be working on in Substance Painter. Working inside these low poly volumes, I add scratches and dents, but they should be exaggerated, otherwise the baker wouldn't be able to catch them or have enough of a visual impact in just the diffuse channel. The main focus is on new secondary or tertiary volumes and of course the main coloring areas through poly groups for efficient masking in Substance Painter. Then I move on to baking these details. It's a very straightforward process. I go about adding some extra hand-painted lighting information as well as the emissive stuff on top. And then the diffuse and emissive textures are ready for export. When it comes to texture variations, I work on them all in the same file. I use these common layers as a basis for looks and feel, and change only the coloring and hand-painted details. Then I'm mindful to enter the appropriate texture set name, as this will be the basis for the exported texture's name. When it comes to rigging these assets, I've used the MGear framework for Maya. This is a suite of tools to build and customize components and streamline the rigging process using the data-centric rigging approach as I've previously explained. I'll provide links that go more in depth into the intricacies behind this approach. Even though the assets I had to build are simple and straightforward, mostly mechanical stuff and leaf joint setups, I opted for this more comprehensive solution due to the large amount of assets and their variants that had to rig and animation variations. After all, every minute I spend on manually rebuilding even the simplest controller setup is a minute of lost productivity. Let's take a look at some key points of this workflow. This framework provides me with a list of components, simple controllers, chains, arms, etc., to compose into a guide that I will then build into a functional rig with just one click. We can also use custom components written in Python. Using predefined components like this, I can early on predict the total number of joints in the hierarchy and stay within an acceptable joint count, while also preserving all the motion requirements. Next comes how fast and easy iterations and variations can get. So for example, I'm in an animation scene now. This is the referenced asset. And let's say I don't like a joint placement. It causes some trouble. I open a new scene, build the rig, fix the joint position, re-import the skin, and that's it. Since everything is done in steps, I pause the building where I want to put some extra effort in, and then continue the building when I'm done. My animation scene is now updated to reflect the change. This is the simplest example possible, but it extrapolates to all manner of major changes and modifications. Another important point is that by using this framework, I'll be kind of forced to use a standardized naming convention that will help in having everything clean and tidy, but also in transferring animation between assets. That's something that I will go on to show a little bit about later. Finally, comes the standardization of the export operation. By using a script to bake and export my animation clips and the model FBX that contains the mesh in the hierarchy, I can easily have all my output conformed into a standardized form. That way, the developers will always have a good idea how to manage the 3D asset files as they come in. To sum it all up, the MGear framework, even though it's commonly used for feature animation production, one can easily extract quite a bit of value for game asset rigging. I will interject a few words about an inbuilt and animation plugin for Maya now. It helped me quite a bit to streamline the animation process, especially for transferring animation between assets and assets variations, or quickly modifying animation curves. Here, for example, I copy the animation from one asset to another with a similar structure and then mirroring it without any extra rigging work under the hood. It proved quite useful in numerous occasions like this. Nick will now go on to showcase some of his shader and rendering work that allowed us quite a bit of draw cold surplus.
Alright, here we go. we have an empty scene with a model of one of our spaceships. Right now we are using the standard shader with an albedo, an emission map and some custom reflections. In these kind of projects, you generally want to use custom reflections instead of environmental ones. A custom reflection cube will look much better at these view angles, and given the size of the models on your screen, you want something vibrant. The first thing we are gonna do is scale down the model so it matches the in-game size in the game view. This will help us focus on the final result. We shouldn't be worried about how the zoomed-in model looks at all, since the players won't be seeing it like this in the game. When rendering a scene, one of the most expensive operations is the lighting calculation. Right now, using the forward renderer and the standard shader, Unity will do all the lighting calculation of the model separately for each pixel. This is normal and the preferred way for high-end platforms like PC or consoles. But when targeting such a diverse and sometimes limited ecosystem like the mobile devices, performance problems start to appear. A lot of games turn off real-time lights altogether and use baked lightning. But we wanted to have a real-time lightning so that all the explosions and action on the screen look even more exciting. Given that we are working on such small screens, we can get away by using much cheaper ways to calculate lights, vertex lighting. In vertex lighting, the lighting calculations happens once for each vertex of the model instead of each pixel. To make a rough comparison, for a model that has 250 vertices and occupy 256 by 256 pixels on the screen, with pixel lightning there would be around 65,000 calculations, while with vertex lightning there would be maximum 250, depending on the visibility of each vertex. We can make other calculations cheaper as well by passing them into the vertex part of the shader. So at this point, we want to switch the rendering path of Unity to an older renderer. We go to Project Settings, Graphics, uncheck Use Defaults in all three tiers. Make sure to uncheck everything else since we are not going to be using these features. And change the rendering path to Legacy Vertex Lit. So now we forced Unity to render everything using vertex lighting. As you can see, the model looks different. That's because the standard shader cannot be used anymore, so Unity falls back to a vertex lit shader. The default vertex lit shader that is available in Unity looks fine. If you optimize your assets around it, you can get great results. However, it's possible to emulate a lot of the features of the standard shader in vertex lit environment. To achieve this, we created a custom shader and used only the necessary calculations to get the exact result we wanted. For a metallic workflow look, we needed to have a reflection opacity and blurriness map. Since we don't use transparency on the 3D models in the game, we used the albedo alpha channel for the intensity. Blurring in real time is very expensive, so instead we used the mip maps of the reflection cube texture to fake the blurriness. We also added rim lighting to further emulate the reflectiveness. Ambient occlusion is baked into the albedo texture, so the only other map we needed was the emission. If you zoom in on the model, this is definitely not a replacement for the standard shader. However, in our case, small models on a small screen, you can barely see the difference. Let's check out some in-game stuff. As you can see, there are a lot of things going on the screen. One important thing is that none of the 3D models use transparent shaders. Everything is opaque. You generally want to avoid transparent shaders because they need the pixel data behind them in order to achieve transparency. That results in more drawing calculations, especially when there are many objects on top of each other. We only use transparent shaders for the effects in the game. Speaking of effects, we don't use post-processing at all, as that adds quite an overhead to the rendering. The bloom-like effect you are seeing is actually geometry. We achieved this by using billboard shaders with some additive rendering and some glow textures. To make sure that these billboards don't intersect with the in-game models, we move their vertices towards the camera in the shader vertex function. Each billboard is placed manually on top of parts we want to look bright. For other things like bullets, we added a glow in their texture. More complex effects like explosions or power-ups use a combination of particles and billboards. Explosions are a very important part of any shooter game. Most of the time they require a lot of composite effects in order to look good. Also, adding a lot of frames to make them smooth makes them quite a costly effect. We had to come up with a way to have smooth explosions with low performance cost. This shader is the result. It uses two images and two gradients to create a smooth animated explosion with smoke with just one draw call. The path texture is a grayscale image which is used to push the flame gradient over its values, and the flame noise adds more detail to the final result. After the explosion is finished, the smoke gradient is pushed over the same images. We animate this using the tint color instead of a slider. That way the explosions can be animated inside the particle system, ending up with a result like this.
We would both like to thank you for taking the time to attend this Unite Now session on lessons and best practices creating our mobile game, Neonverse. We hope you've picked up a few things to help build your Unity skills and advance your projects. Be sure to check out the Unite Now page for other sessions, and of course the MGR Framework site and YouTube channel for more detailed and arguably more comprehensive info on the data-centric rigging approach. Also an input. So think of beauty for animators, so check it out. Once more, thank you all.